Previous lecture. Unique sexual human behavior. 1 second before it occurs. Limbic structures, some have sex difference. Ethological releasing stimuli trigger the nervous system. Hormone dependency creating sexually pheromones. Testosterone males. Estrogen females. Pheromone made of hormones breakdown. Perfumes. Endocrine status, affecting the perception of pheromones. Men prefer pheromones derived from women around the time when women are ovulating, a testosterone-dependent phenomenon. Today. Physiological effects of sexual pheromones between sexes. Wellesley effect. Females synchronize each other's cycles, being done by pheromones. The smell of an adult female will delay the onset of puberty of younger females. This is reproductive competition. If you arrest the development of other females, you leave more copies of your genes. Males smelling the pheromones of other males. It depends on the dominance rank. Monkeys and rodent males are able to differentiate between smells of a low or high rank male. If they smell the pheromones of a high rank male, sometimes, it drives down their testosterone levels. In other case, there's a sudden burst of sperm production. In rodents. Males around a female. It accelerates puberty onset in the female. In rodents. Females around a male. It increases testosterone level and sperm production. Pigs are inducible ovulators. A synthetic pheromone boar mate is an ovulation inducer in female boars. Made of a male-derived pheromone of truffles. More beard growth, if you are around a females. Homosexual men prefer the smell of other men, when men have higher testosterone levels. When women are ovulation, they prefer the smell of men, also their noses become more sensitive to such levels, because estrogen has all sorts of receptors on olfactory neurons. All these pheromonal changes are not affected by your relatives. Gustatory stimuli. Giraffes. Flamening. It gets reproductive information by licking the private parts of other giraffes. Auditory stimuli. Moose. Inducible ovulating. Women. Voices get a little bit higher around ovulation. The idea of all of these are subliminal processes. It's false. In humans. Thought is the releaser. Because we're not an olfactory species, or auditory, etc. Environmental factors. Fear as suppressive of reproductive behavior. Extreme rage suppress reproductive behavior. Chronic stress is extremely suppressive of reproductive physiology and behavior. Short-term stress. In males. It depends, it can stimulate or inhibit. Coolidge effect. The male is sated sexually. But you put a different female, and things start all over again. What happen in longer-term hormones? How much sexual behavior is in women, depends on where she is in her cycle. In some species. You only get female proceptive seeking of sex around ovulation. In humans. A big increase around day 14, and again increase around day 28, the same happens in the likelihood of having an orgasm. The day 28, it's because they're more relaxed about a fear of pregnancy. A high estrogen is when you get more sexual behavior. The most reliable effect, in more sexual arousal around the time of ovulation. Women, wear more provocative clothing around ovulation. Jeffrey Miller. Around the time of ovulation, lap dancers get larger tips. Building block of that. Females. More estrogen levels equals more stimulation of receptors for progesterone. Progesterone is related to the rewarding aspects of sex. More estrogen equals more synthesis of oxytocin. Oxytocin is related to attachment. Women will feel more affiliative with someone they've had sex with around ovulation. More estrogen equals lowers the threshold of certain tactile receptors. Women around ovulation, more estrogen. They're more sensitive to touch. More estrogen equals lowers the threshold for detecting the smell of males. Females release androgens, male sex hormones. It increases sexual motivation. Males. Testosterone. Around 30 years old, the testosterone levels go down exponentially. Testosterone levels drop, when they become fathers, in return, vasopressin levels go up. More sexually active men equals more testosterone, and vice versa. But the testosterone levels never go to 0%, there's always a remnant. So, the question is, how much residual sexual behavior is left? The more sexual experience before castration equals the more testosterone retained after castration. Environment/social experience strikes again. E.g. to castrate a male. Then you inject 10% of testosterone, or 200% of testosterone. And in both cases, the testosterone goes back to 100% of the same sexual behavior as before. It means the brain circuitry involved in sexual motivation, it requires testosterone. but that part is not concerned with the exact level of testosterone. So, if there's a tight relationship between the amount of sexual behavior and testosterone levels, it's not because of testosterone levels drive the behavior. It's because the behavior drives higher testosterone levels. But only, in the castrated rodent. If you increase the testosterone levels by 1000%, the sexual behavior increases dramatically. This is what happens with people abusing anabolic steroids. Testosterone is not playing a strictly causative role, testosterone is playing a modulatory role. Melatonin. It tells the body what time of year it is. For seasonal mating. Sensitive to the amount of light per day over recent weeks, which melatonin triggers the onset of mating season. Perinatal factors. Perinatal equals before birth. Prenatal equals after birth. Postnatal equals very early development. Environmental factors. Early environment affects adult sexual life. Early experience is about learning the appropriate social contexts for sexual behavior. E.g. primates. Raised in cages, isolated, with peers, with no mother, etc. When they reach adulthood, they do the same sexual behavior, but they do it in socially inappropriate context. The same sexual fixed action patterns, on the towel in the room. In the kibbutz community. If you spent the first 6 years with someone, you decide you can't mate with her because he's like a sibling. What early experience have to do with sexual orientation? Two ideas. One, the absence of a father. Increasing the likelihood of being homosexual. Two, having a screwed up mother. Also increasing the likelihood. Both ideas are nonsense, there's no evidence for it. Organizational hormonal effect, the effects of hormones when you were little, organizing what kind of brain you're developing in sexual behavior. Activational hormone effect. But it's not a big effect, it changes virtually nothing. Perinatal period. Expose a female monkey fetus to high testosterone levels. And you masculinize the brain. But when she gets into adulthood, if nothing else is different, it has no effects at all. If you had a female with a masculinized brain, and you inject her androgens with testosterone, you get male fixed action patterns of sexual behavior. In people abusing anabolic steroids, does the body downregulate the number of testosterone receptors? Yes, but you can't never downregulate them low enough to compensate the testosterone signal. Perinatal androgenization of females. Where female fetuses will get heavily androgenized. Two circumstances. One, when you have a disease of an overactive adrenal system, you pump out to high levels of testosterone congenital adrenal hyperplasia CAH. Adrenal glands makes testosterone, in females it pumps maybe 5% the level that males do. 2. Diethylstilbestrol, DA, drug used to prevent miscarriage. But in some cases, the DA was converted to androgens. In CAH, it was going to have masculinizing effects on their behavior. Around adolescence started the different behavior. And a more likelihood to become lesbian. But if you were prenatally androgenized, you would born with weirdo genital. So, they had to gone through reconstructive plastic surgery. Things were not merely a change in hormone levels. Prenatal environment on sexual identification. Steroid hormones in the brain. Testosterone, it binds to testosterone receptors, and does its steroid hormone transcription factor deal. In some parts of the body, testosterone binds to testosterone receptor. Or, testosterone converts into dihydrotestosterone. But testosterone's actions are due to being converted to estrogen, TEND binds to estrogen receptors and causes male typical behaviors. It goes as follows. Once testosterone enters a target cell, it's inside the cell, the testosterone is turned to estrogen, only in some parts of the body, like in the brain, genitals, sexual areas of skin. So, a question rise. Why isn't mom and her estrogen androgenizing every single fetus? A protein, which occurs during pregnancy, that occurs in the circulation, which it binds estrogen, and take it out of action. So, estrogen in the bloodstream of a fetus never has effect on any cell in the body. Alpha fetoprotein. It also means you don't get prenatal feminizing effects from estrogen. Now, where the brain feminization come from? Other hormones do it. Testicular feminized males. The individual is chromosomally male, has undescended testes, is producing tons of testosterone, all due to a mutation in the testosterone receptor. So, you wind up with an individual whose sexual identity is female. Because, you're not going to get any signaling mediated by testosterone, nor by dihydrotestosterone, but you're going to get normal masculinization of the brain by way of estrogen. In other words, testicular feminized males, whose sex identification have been female, nonetheless, prenatally they had masculinization organizational effects on the brain. Genetics. Genes and sexual behavior. Genes determine which gonads you made as a fetus. Sex hormones you were secreting. Genitals. Secondary sexual stuff. Genes and sexual orientation. Certain degree of heritability of sexual orientation. Identical twins, 50% concordance of sexual orientation. It means, if a twin is homosexual, their identical twin has a 50% chance of being homosexual. Non-identical twins, 22% covariance. Other twins, 9% covariance. More genes plus more environment equals more chances of having the same sexual orientation as your brother. Genetic markers for sexual orientation. Dean Hamer. Certain gene locations that were more likely you be shared between homosexual siblings. But 1. It was a genetic marker. 2. No consistency, it was different gene in different twins. All of this was nonsense. Evolutionary biology of those genes. The proteins made by those genes. Organisms have sex for the good of the species. But what about non-reproductive sex? Like bonobos, they're a separate species of chimp. Normal chimps are a tournament species, extreme high levels of male aggression. Bonobos, no sexual dimorphism, have female dominance, astonishing amounts of sex. So, it's a pair bonding species. But, they're the most sexually promiscuous species. Mostly non-reproductive sex. But why? It's about promoting group cohesion. Because every time anything happens to them, they groom each other. Along with decreasing individual tension, reconciliation. What does it cost you to reproduce? Where eggs, pregnancy and postnatal care is hugely expensive. As a result, females are more selective about who they will mate to. Pair bonding species. Marmosets. Where the male does the same amount of care as the female, and she always give birth to twins. Males attempting to control female reproductive behavior. In primates. The male will mate guarding, he tries to keep the female away from any other male. In humans. Clitoridectomies. Chastity belts. Extended periods of men being away from women. Linear access model of reproduction. A baboon group. And there's only one female who is ovulating. And the alpha male is the one who mates with her. Two females ovulating, the males number 1 and 2 in the hierarchy, and so on. But is not quite so clear. Males attempting to limit female access to other males. Copulatory plugs. In dogs. The semen plugs if left in the vagina, which hardens into a plug. Or in flies. The penis is barbed. And the barb go in the opposite direction, so the penis keeps in there, they can make new ones. Sperm competition. In flies. The sperm containing toxins, that will kill the sperm of another male. Males, decrease the sexual attractiveness of the female, after mating. In flies. Release a chemical, which decreases mating pheromone production in the female. Or decreases sexual proceptivity in the female. Female counter strategies. In humans. Hidden ovulation. Which decrease paternity certainty. It's a good mechanism for decreasing competitive infanticide. Or decreases male attempt to control female sexual behavior. When ovulation is actually occurring. Increases the likelihood to mate with somebody else. Females faking estrus. Pseudo-estrus. So, males don't control female sexual access. Male-male competition in evolution and sexual behavior. Linear access. One male, one female, and so on. The leading cause of aggression is male-male aggression for female access. Sperm competition. Monogamous species, small amounts of sperm, small testes. Like gorillas. Polygamous species, high number of sperms, to outcompete other guys' sperm, or making a sperm plug, large test. Like chimps. Humans, again, right in the middle. Female-female competition. Tournament species, females don't choose who they're mating, linear access model. But that's not really the case. What determines who a female mate with is the winner of the male-male competition. But there's female choice. In tournament species. Primates. Male is twice as bigger, he's physically able to dominate the female. So the female will exhaust the guy. In baboons, they go walk, and the female leave the male right in front of his worst rival, again and again, until they fight, and after that, she has a stolen copulation with the guy she likes. But who females baboons want to mate with? She mates with males, who are nice to them, who groom them a lot, who play with their infants, don't beat on them. Intersexual friendships. At first, they were just friends, but later on, they copulate. But there's a problem. If this happens, it's more likely that the real father is the low-ranking guy who was good with the female. But when the offspring ages, he will fight against high-ranking males, because they're supposed that he is the offspring of the high-ranked male. So, he will get beat up for the truly high-ranked males. Orangutans. Male-male competition. Aggression around reproductive access to females. And low-ranking males who never mate. But the low-ranking has a strategy. They rape females. Or in fish species. Low-ranking males pretend to be a female, and pretend to be friends. And suddenly they have a penis.